This show is part of the RetroZap.com podcast network.
This is what you can look forward to on episode 159 of Skywalking Through Neverland. I was wearing my Rapunzel shirt.
Oh, they loved you.
Yeah.
You were a walking billboard.
I know. Oh, it's great.
You guys are the cutest podcast couple ever.
No, wait a minute. How do you get to be 33 and never had seen any of the Star Wars films?
The thing about watching them in order that we're discovering is it makes the storytelling better.
And they would do for a warm-up, like, Mark Hamill can hear you. Make some noise.
That's how it's done.
Absolutely.
You just push that big red button.
You take those moments when you can get them.
So we take that as a definite consolation, knowing that what we did was appreciated by a lot of people.
Best day ever!
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls.
Hello, Skywalkers.
Listen.
Ah, Neverland.
I only hope that we never lose sight of one thing, that it was all started by a mountain.
Wow. Oh, what?
You are skywalking through Neverland.
Hey, Skywalkers, welcome to
Skywalking Through Neverland.
This is your fun-filled Star Wars and Disney podcast that leads you on a tour through decades of fandom. I am Richard Woloski. And now, everyone, please say hello to my sweetie wife, Sarah, who's celebrating a birthday this Friday, March the 10th.
Happy birthday! Happy, happy birthday to you!
Yeah, so we'll just call this our birthday episode. What do you think about that?
Sweetie birthday episode.
Yay! A Tangled birthday again. I love it.
And she's 29 years old.
Yes.
29 years young.
It doesn't matter that a while ago I had a 30th birthday party that was Tangled themed.
Well, we were looking forward to your 30th anniversary.
Oh, okay. That makes sense.
Your 30th birthday party.
I like it.
It was
okay.
A preview of your 30th birthday party. Just leave it at that.
Oh, there we go. All right. Well, welcome to our Star Wars and Disney family. Now, we like to start every show with a giant Wookiee hug to our family of Skywalkers who listen to the show every week. Also, the Scopewalkers and the Face Huggers who watch our live stream. And everyone who tweets at us at Skywalking Pod or posts in our Facebook group and just shares the positivity about our collective adventure through fandom.
This is where fans go to find the bright center of the universe.
Aww.
Do you know where the bright center of the universe was on Sunday night? When we saw Rogue One again for the sixth time at the worst cinema in the world, the Long Beach Town Center.
Yeah.
It's the cinema to go to if you want people talking and texting and putting their feet up on the chair in front of you.
Yes.
Had to be said. So don't see any movies there, but it was the only theater in this area still playing Rogue One.
Yeah.
So we had to see it again before it hits DVD in just a couple of weeks.
Yeah, exciting. So I really enjoyed seeing that again, and I'm glad we did that now before the run of March movies. Oh my gosh.
Yeah. That was our sixth time. So Face Huggers and Scope Walkers, how many times have you seen Rogue One in the theaters so far? Who was it that saw it 29 times?
Oh, gosh. I don't remember now.
Four times as Ray Gob.
Okay.
This is where we took the picture of the Last Jedi movie poster we saw in the lobby.
Yeah. Now, I could have sworn it was red in red letters, but the picture looked like it was yellow.
Yeah. I don't remember. So, you know what? I want to go back to that theater. Mm-hmm. And not give them our patronage, but I just want to see the movie poster because, you know what? I don't remember it being yellow.
Right.
But it could have been.
No.
Only three for me, says Mental Madness.
Oh, Dave Parfit. Only once.
What?
Are you ashamed, Dave? Are you ashamed?
Dave Parfit, Adventures by Daddy, everyone.
Two times, says Kimberly. And I think Amanda said three. Amanda Bond. Yeah, so... Well, that's cool.
And each time we notice something different, and I wish I could remember what... There's a couple of different audio cues I heard that I didn't hear before.
Mm-hmm.
Don't recall what they were. So let's let's just move on.
Dave Parfit is quite ashamed. Yeah, oh, well, Michael, 7.
Michael, 7. Wow.
Thank you.
All right. Let's move on to telling everyone that we are recording this from the aforementioned Long Beach, California on March the 7th, 2017. You know what? If my grandfather were alive, he would be 117 years old today.
Whoa.
I was buying you some time before I asked you, Sarah, what time it was.
Minnie's not ready yet.
All right, so then I'll regale everyone with tales of how my grandfather and I used to go and see a Star Wars movie, and at the end of The Empire Strikes Back, you want to know what the name of the chap who was falling.
Oh, okay.
said there was one guy who fell a lot. What was his name? He didn't call him a guy. He called him a chap. All right, so, Sarah, what time is it?
It's 12:24. Good afternoon.
All right. Well, you know what? Let's tell everyone what's coming up on today's big show.
Okay. Okay. Can I do it? Can I do it?
Go right ahead. Go. Okay. This is your show. Oh, your birthday show.
Oh, my gosh. So on today's show, we will be talking about Tangled. Because Tangled, Before Ever After, the new Disney Channel movie will be premiering March 10th. March 10th. That's
your
my birthday.
Birthday. Ah. They planned that.
I know. So we were invited to a screening of that film, which was followed by a Q&A with the supervising director, Chris Sonnenberg, and the supervising producer of the series, Ben Balestrieri. So we will have great stories to share, as well as some behind-the-scenes insight into Tangled, the series. So I'm so excited. Oh my gosh. And we have some stories from interactions with them too, so I'm excited.
We also have a Skywalker story from Amanda Bond and Gabriel Colbaugh. Dale Wentland tells us about his new podcast series, Discovering Star Wars, and we have shout-outs and a Skywalker of the Week.
And as a reminder, Skywalkers, we have a new Star Wars Celebration Orlando t-shirt design. Now, it's not just a t-shirt, but it is available on TeePublic right now, and you can pick out the color of your t-shirt. You can use it. You can get a laptop case. You can get a mug. What else do they have? They have a travel mug, like all kinds of cool things you can get with TeePublic t-shirts. So just head to skywalkingthroughneverland.com and click on the Support Us tab to get to the TeePublic store. Well, you'll be able to see that design. And it's a really cool design, and some people who bought it right away have already got the t-shirts in and are sharing on social media the pictures.
Yeah, thanks to everyone for posting their pictures of the new Skywalking Celebration Orlando shirt.
Yeah. Oh, it's amazing. So I want to give a big thanks to that.
All right. Now, let's dust off an old chestnut and see how many more days until some big events in the years to come with Cliff's Notes Countdown.
Cliff's Notes.
Cliff Note Countdown.
Cliff's Notes. Cliff's Notes.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Cliff's Notes.
All right. So now, let's start with Beauty and the Beast.
Ooh. Well, that comes out March 17th. So guess what? There's only 10 days until that movie airs.
Yeah, and so all of this Cliff's Notes Countdown will consider from today.
Mm, okay.
So the days until starts today, March 7th. Yes.
Okay.
So 10 more days until Beauty and the Beast. And as a little foreshadowing, next week's episode, we're going to tell you all about the new movie with Emma Watson.
Yes, and David Iger just posted that the Beauty and the Beast soundtrack is available this Friday, my birthday, March 10th.
Oh, well, there you go. Yeah, we went to a screening and a press conference for Beauty and the Beast, so we'll have lots to share with that. All right, next up, WonderCon Anaheim. This was recommended by Kai Charles, who wanted us to add this to the list. That's coming up March 31st of this year. I didn't know WonderCon was coming up that quickly.
Yeah, usually it's on Easter weekend. So this is coming out very soon.
All right, so that is 23 more days.
Mm-hmm. All right, and Star Wars Celebration Orlando, happening April 13th through 16th in Orlando. Well, oh my gosh, that is only 37 days away.
Wow.
I can't believe that.
Yikes. So excited.
I know. I got to get cracking. We got some work to do.
All right. Yeah. 37 more days. All right. Next, the weekend after Celebration Orlando will be the Dark Side Half Marathon at Walt Disney World. So you runners, you only have 44 more days until April the 20th.
To prepare for that one. Yikes.
Yeah. Then we start with some summer movies.
Yeah.
Like the one that's going to kick it all off. Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2, which comes out May the 5th, 2017.
Okay.
Only 59 more days.
Wow. Less than 60 days.
So which means like a week or two after that, we're going to see the ride at California Adventure.
Okay.
That's
right. They said
it's going to come
May.
Going to be coming out right around the time of the movie.
Yeah. I think it's May 25th, but I'm not sure.
That would make sense because it's Memorial Day weekend.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So the ride will open somewhere around there.
Okay.
All right. Next, got to add this one in here. Alien Covenant. That one's devoted to all of you face huggers out there. Got to get an alien reference in there somewhere. And that is 73 more days. Now, I didn't know that this was Prometheus 2.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I got schooled on Alien by Mark Rogoshowitz yesterday. But this one here, it's going to have aliens in it.
Oh.
So, awesome.
All right.
All right. And next up, Star Wars turns 40.
Excellent.
Let that one sink in. On May the 25th, 2017, and only 79 more days until that big, giant celebration. What are we gonna do for this?
I don't know. May 4th, we have something planned, but
right,
May
but,
25th...
You know, we're gonna, oh, okay. This is just dawning on me. We're going to plan a big show for the 40th anniversary.
Mm-hmm.
Make a note of that.
All right.
All right.
Now, Wonder Woman comes out on June 2nd. I'm so excited for this film. And that is only 88 days away.
And then behind that is going to be Cars 3.
Okay.
Coming out June the 16th. That's 101 more days. Now, are we excited about Cars 3?
I am not. I'm not the biggest Cars fan, but I know some people who are, namely my birthday doppelganger, Teresa.
Okay. Yeah, Cars 2 diminished my love for the Cars film series, you
gotcha.
Want to call it that. And then next up, Spider-Man Homecoming on July the 7th. That's 122 more days, and let's see how many more times Peter Parker can insult Star Wars fans by calling us old.
Hey, guys, you ever see that really old movie, Empire Strikes Back?
Oh. Nice. That's funny.
All right. And then after that, one of my personal favorites, War for the Planet of the Apes, coming out July the 14th. One of the only films I'm really looking forward to this summer.
Okay. But you know what? You're going to have to challenge me for July 14th because that's when D23 Expo begins in Anaheim this year. Well, it's always been in Anaheim, which is awesome for us. And that is only 129 days away. And I'm as a Disney fan, I'm excited. But seeing as how last time in 2015, the D23 Expo shared all kinds of new Star Wars land and Star Wars news, like, I am so looking forward to that as well. So I know now D23 Expo is now on Star Wars fans' radars.
Yeah,
because
it's
of that.
It's almost like Celebration 2.
Yeah, absolutely.
So hopefully we'll get a screening for War for the Planet of the Apes.
I have a feeling... At D23?
No, beforehand. I don't think Disney's going to want to promote a 20th Century Fox film. If they did, that'd be great.
Yes.
All right. And then we have Blade Runner 2049.
Ooh.
Coming out October the 6th, 2017. That's not 129 more days. That's 213 more days. I'm really looking forward to Blade Runner 2. This is going to be awesome because I think Blade Runner was one of those really underappreciated Harrison Ford movies when it came out.
Now, is Harrison Ford in this?
Yes. Yeah.
He
is in this.
You know what? You know the reason I didn't really appreciate Blade Runner, the first one?
Because you were one?
No. Well, no, I saw it when I was old enough to get it. But
okay.
You want to know why?
Why?
Because I hated Harrison Ford's haircut. He did not look cute. I'm sorry.
It all comes down to that.
It really does for us.
Well, how about the hair on this one? Thor Ragnarok.
Ooh.
Now we're talking some hair.
Yeah, we are. I'm excited for this. And that's November the 3rd. And that is in 241 days. Now, as a side note, I have met Chris
Hemsworth.
Hemsworth. in person. He wasn't wearing the Thor outfit. It's not the same. I'm just saying.
You're just saying that because I'm in the room, aren't you?
No, I'm not. It's not the same.
Okay. Okay, I feel better about myself.
Yes.
All right. And then, brace yourself. Star Wars Episode 8, The Last Jedi.
Woohoo!
I guess we can take Episode 8 out of that now and just call it Star Wars The Last Jedi.
Yeah. Yeah. And that is December 15th. Wow. Each time they keep on getting closer and closer. And that is 283 days away. And we will be doing the lineingup.net thing at the Star Wars, at the Star Wars Chinese Theater. At the...
Yeah, see? See? It's not that easy, is it?
At the TCL Chinese Theater IMAX.
Let's just have it on record that even you messed that up.
I know. It's become the Star Wars Theater to me because that's what we watch there.
Yeah, let's just call it the Star Wars Theater. That works for me.
So, yeah, if you want to like have a meetup or have a really amazing time and watch Star Wars with a ton of like friends, you know, it's that's a great place to see it.
And then coming next year, 2018, we have Wreck-It Ralph 2 to look forward to on March the 9th, a day before your birthday.
Aw, I love that. I love it. And so March 9th, wow, 367 days away.
Yeah. Hey, Joey Pitty just asked why I'm not dressed like Flynn Rider, since you're dressed like Rapunzel right now. You're cosplaying, and I even have a Flynn Rider outfit.
Well, you know, you can go get the just the jacket.
I know. I'm so embarrassed. I'm so embarrassed that
now
I didn't
think
about that.
I want you to go get the jacket.
All right. I will in a couple of minutes.
Okay. After All we right. finish this.
Then we have the Young Han Solo movie.
Yay.
And that comes out May 25th, 2018, which is 444 more days until today, March the 7th.
Okay. Star Wars Episode 9, as yet untitled, is coming out May 24th, 2019. At least for now.
Yeah.
Who thinks that they're going to move that to a December release?
Oh, no, no. Don't even start that.
I think they're going to move that to a December release. And right, as of now, it is 808 days away.
So we're getting the Young Han Solo movie 5 months after The Last Jedi. Then we get to wait a whole nother year for Episode 9?
It's true.
I know. Hey, Disney, if you're listening, let's do a Star Wars movie a week now.
Aw, yes.
How about that? All right.
Cool.
Now, of course, all these dates are subject to change, so okay. Don't hold us to it.
All right. And Jim Scooby Meyer just wrote, I just discovered a podcast and absolutely love it. Thank you for all your work and entertaining Star Wars Disney fans. You should call Facebook folks Face Windus.
Face Windus.
Thank you,
Face
Jim.
Windus.
That was very lovely sentiment. Yes. We appreciate it.
I think Face Hugger's already stuck.
We like that because we can use sound effects.
We like Face Windus as well. So we'll keep that one in our back pocket.
Yeah.
All right. And now with that, let's hear about the gift that Disney has given you, Sarah, on March the 10th, because the Disney Channel will air Tangled Before Ever After, the movie that will lead into the new Tangled series. Now, we went to a screening and press conference and got some great insight into some new adventures of Rapunzel, Flynn, Pascal, and many, many others.
Best day ever!
Coming to Disney Channel, Rapunzel is back. In a brand new Disney Channel original movie, Tangled Before Ever After.
Holy hair!
Being a princess isn't easy.
How do people walk in these things?
Just relax. This is going to be fine.
And for Rapunzel, life... Lady Kane is about to get hairy.
Load them up, boys!
Now, it's up to Rapunzel.
Dad?
Rapunzel, stay back.
To win back her kingdom.
Let them go.
That's my girl.
Yeah.
Don't miss the Disney Channel original movie, Tangled Before Ever After, coming to Disney Channel.
So on Monday, March 6th, we were invited to a screening of Tangled Before Ever After, which was followed by a Q&A with executive producer and supervising directors Chris Sonnenberg and supervising producer Ben Balistrieri. Now, the movie will air on Disney Channel March 10th, my birthday, and the series then debuts 2 weeks later on March 24th with the episode What the Hair?
Best title ever.
Right? All right, so in Tangled Before Ever After, this is the movie, Rapunzel grapples with the responsibility of being a princess and the overprotective ways of her father. So while she wholeheartedly loves Eugene, of course, Flynn Rider, which you're dressed as right now, Rapunzel does not share his immediate desire to get married and settle down within the castle walls. I mean, she was just in a tower all her life, for goodness sake, so she wants to get out and explore. So determined to live life on her own terms, she and her tough-as-nails lady-in-waiting Cassandra embark on a secret adventure where they encounter mystical rocks that magically cause Rapunzel's long blonde hair to grow back. Impossible to break and difficult to hide, Rapunzel must learn to embrace her hair and all that it represents.
A really fun-filled TV movie.
Definitely.
All right, so now, once again, Mandy Moore reprises her role and voices Rapunzel.
Yay!
Zachary Levi voices Flynn Rider.
Excellent.
Aiden Espinosa, a former Disney cast member, she voices the lady-in-waiting Cassandra.
Cool. And Julie Bowen from Modern Family voices Queen Ariana.
Clancy Brown voices Frederick, Clancy Savage Opress from Star Wars The Clone Wars.
And this is King Frederick, Rapunzel's
father.
He voices father.
King Frederick, right? He didn't voice King Frederick in the movie, did he?
In the Tangled? No. No, in fact, in the movie, the king and the queen did not have names, and they never spoke.
Oh, that's right.
I found interesting. Yeah, it was just their facial expressions that kind of determined everything.
And we also hear many other very familiar voices in the cast, like Steve Bloom, Dee Bradley Baker, and Pat Carroll.
Yeah, really awesome voice cast. I love it.
Yeah. All right, so now, what did you think of Tangled Before Ever After, Sarah? What was your impression?
Well, of course, I mean, I'm a Rapunzel fan, so I loved it. And I think if you are a Rapunzel fan, you will love it. I mean, and it's interesting, you know, it begins and Rapunzel has her brown hair and it's okay, you know, but once she gets her blonde hair back, it's like, ah, that's Rapunzel, you know? So for me, that's how I identify her with her Rapunzel, her long blonde hair.
And this takes place right before Tangled Ever After, which was the short film where Rapunzel and Flynn get married.
Yeah, it's in between the movie and the short film. I wouldn't say right before, just because the whole series is kind of leading up to this end point of them getting married. And there's going to go on lots of adventures, at least from what the directors were telling us.
This series is the Clone Wars to Revenge of the Sith. It bridges.
Yes.
It bridges Attack of the Clones and Revenge of the Sith. So this series will bridge Tangled the movie with Tangled Ever After, the short film, where she had brown hair.
Yeah, she did have brown hair.
So what's up with that?
Well, somehow she's going to have to get her brown hair back, I guess. Maybe she can choose on any given day.
But you know what? We're going to hear a little bit more about that because that was one of the questions that was asked during the Q&A.
Mm-hmm.
Now let's hear some more of your reactions to the movie.
Well, okay, so in the first 5 minutes, and this clip is out there for all of you, there's a fun little moment. Mm-hmm. With bunnies.
Bunnies.
With bunnies.
We were the only ones in the screening room to laugh.
It was so funny because, you know, Hoojibs, bunnies, we love them. So to have them so prominently featured in Tangled was amazing. And I think the movie did a very good job of kind of establishing characters. I thought that Flynn particularly, you know, the voice acting of
Zachary Levi
was great. Like, he really brought the character back, and that kind of dry humor.
Right.
It really moved along the tale, and I thought it was great. So he was my favorite, I would say.
So now, what was your impression when you heard that they were going to continue the Rapunzel saga with Disney Channel series?
Oh, well, because that announcement came along with the fact that the original cast was back, I was all in. The fact that Mandy Moore, Zachary Levi, and Alan Menken writing music was back, I thought was great.
One thing that I'm liking about the current Disney movies with songs, the songs are shorter.
Mm,
they're like,
yes.
Like even in Moana, the songs are like 2 minutes, 2.5 minutes. I'm not the biggest musical fan. So when I hear a song about to start, it's like, just get on with it.
Aww.
But with Moana, I loved the songs because they were short, and I knew that going forward, the songs were going to be a little bit shorter. So when the songs came on, I didn't mind it as much. Plus with the bonus that the songs were really good in Moana. The same here. The songs were short in Tangled, Before Ever After, and the songs were really, really good.
Mm-hmm.
Now, going back to my question about what did you think when they were going to continue with the Rapunzel saga? Now, I know sometimes when Disney releases a straight-to-DVD movie, kind of diminishes the special feeling that you have for the original.
Okay.
If this had been a straight-to-DVD release, I would have been disappointed that they even went there.
Okay, yeah, I can see that. I definitely can see
but
that.
But now with a series, they can develop these characters.
Right.
And develop stories and develop the songs.
And from the Q&A, it sounds like they have developed a huge story arc. So we'll get into that a little bit more.
All right, you know what? Let's do that now.
Okay.
Because we don't want to give away too much about this TV movie, which premieres once again on Sarah's birthday.
March 10th. I've got my DVR set, and I'll probably be live tweeting a little bit with all of you who are excited.
I'm sure. Now, immediately right after the movie, there was a Q&A with executive producer and supervising director Chris Sonnenberg and supervising producer Ben Balestrieri. And they came into the room and were answering questions from the press. And the first question was a really good one.
So what made you decide to continue with Rapunzel on her story?
That's a question that keeps getting brought up. Why did we continue the story with her? And for me, it really kind of came down to, I have two daughters. At the time, were 14 and 12, are now 15 and 17. And there just seemed to be this idea, and it didn't really like weigh on me too much, but just looking at the story, that there was this moment at the end of the movie where they meet, right, and they fall in love. And then there's this short, Tangled Ever After, where they get married. And just looking at the two of those moments, I was wondering, like, what happened? Did they get to know each other a little bit more? Like, what happened in between that time? And then there's this great line at the end of the movie where Eugene Fitzherbert or Flynn Rider says, after years and years of asking and asking, I finally said yes. You know, there's that kind of fun line that he says there, which he might be kind of, you know, joking about. But I was like, maybe there was some time in between there. And it started to become like, what do I have to say about this time in these people's lives, in young people's lives? About getting to know yourself, getting to know the people in your lives, getting to understand your relationship with your parents. And if the kids from... that had seen the movie in 2010, were maybe 10 at the time, or 8, then they're probably getting to be about 17 years old, and they might want to know, like, how is this character that I loved so much as a kid coming to grips with this part of her life? And that was kind of, for me, the in of why to tell the story and how to tell the story.
So it sounds like the audience for this series... it might be a little older than the typical Disney Channel TV series. Just because of what Chris was saying about how, you know, kids might have seen Rapunzel and Fallen in Love in 2010 and now they're 7 years older. So they might be interested to know what Rapunzel is doing now.
Whereas Elena of Avalor and even Sophia the First are geared toward...
younger.
The 4 and 5 year olds.
Right.
What age would you say that this series is geared toward?
That's a really hard one. I bet they want to bring in the 4 and 5 year olds.
Definitely. That's where the merchandising is.
Exactly. And I think it was a simple enough plot line that they can definitely follow along.
Mm-hmm.
But I know for us fans who know a little bit more, like the fact that Alan Menken's doing the music or you know, we have our main cast back and the people who love Rapunzel as a whole will tune in just to see what her story is continuing to be.
I think seeing how rebellious Rapunzel is,
mm-hmm.
I think it'll bring in the younger than tween audience.
Yeah.
I can see girls 10 and 11
definitely
really getting into this.
Yeah, I think so too. And even Christopher Marino will tune in and love Tangled.
Yeah.
Yay.
Yeah, so I'd say this would be I know they want to get the younger crowd.
Mm-hmm.
I would say 3 to 11.
Okay.
That sound good?
It does. And, you know, if you think about it, this reminds me so much of like Clone Wars or Star Wars Rebels because, yes, those series are geared toward a younger audience. And yet all of us who are older tune in just to see the story. So I think Tangled is a franchise that can do that.
Oh, yeah.
A strong, you know, it's a strong fan base, and we will tune in.
All right. Next question was from my sweetie wife, Sarah.
Yes, I jumped in. I had a question right away because as podcasters, you get to do this on your feet very fast. You get to have these questions ready. So my question, well, let's just play it for you guys.
I love that Rapunzel, she's back to blonde. I mean, I identify with her as the blonde Rapunzel. And I'm wondering, why was that decision? Was that like a marketing decision or was that more than that?
Well, I mean, ultimately, her name's Rapunzel, right? Long blonde hair. You know, if you're going to tell a story about the Hulk, you're not going to tell like about a dog, right? You know, he's got to be big and green. And I think Rapunzel has to be long and blonde hair for it to kind of just read as the character. The really, for me, the trick about it and what ultimately was the trick for the filmmakers in the original movie was to give the hair a reason for being blonde and for being long and in our case being uncuttable. So all of the big story, the big question that we always ask in the story room is always why? Why do these things exist? Why are we telling this story? And you know, her hair, it represents her personality. It's bigger than life. It's bright. It's long. It shines. It's magical. It's pretty much who Rapunzel is. And so, and then the added layer of it, which is being unbreakable, has its own reason for being that we're going to get into as we go along in the story. But it always should always go back to serving the purpose. Why does it exist this way?
Man, I love his description of Rapunzel's personality and how it matches the hair.
Yeah.
I think that it like said so much by him saying that it kind of solidified why I like Rapunzel so much. Does that make sense?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Oh, like, and you with the blonde hair.
I know. I was like, I totally identify. Oh my gosh. So, and one thing I have noticed about people who love and identify with Rapunzel is that we're all very artistic. So any Rapunzel themed parties that I've seen, they're always full of DIY decorations. The cakes are usually made by, you know, the moms or the kids. There's the food and the costumes are all handmade, and it's kind of reflected in Rapunzel herself, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So in this movie, she is given a journal. And what do you usually do in journals, Richard? Well, we know what you do because we have Journal of the Rich.
Yes.
You write down.
I write all of my personal thoughts.
Yes. But what do you think Rapunzel does with her journal?
I'm going to say she does something very artistic in them.
Yes, she does. She draws her experiences. She doesn't write them down.
Oh.
So, yeah. So one blogger asked about this.
I love the journal aspect. Is there any special meaning?
Yeah. It's two things. Number one, again, I'm very much fed by my daughters. My daughter, my older daughter, Ariana, Queen Ariana, I named the queen after her. And the reason we named her after my daughter is because she had gone on, right when we were breaking the story and figuring out what everything was going to be, she had gone on this this trip to Mexico with a huge group of people to build houses for people in kids in Mexico. And again, she was 14 and had just turned 14, and she was going on this big trip, and I didn't know if she was ready for it. I didn't know if I was ready for it. My wife and I were like, is she old enough to do it? Like, go by herself and everything. And there seemed to be this kind of like questioning of, you know, is she prepared for this? She's our little baby. Is she ready for this life of traveling beyond borders and all this kind of huge life excitement? And she went, and she had come back, and they had given her these journals to kind of take notes and get to know people stuff. When she had come back, the little journal was completely covered in drawings of the little girls that she met and how she learned how to put a hinge on a door, and she learned how to do all this fun stuff, and she dropped her phone in water and all this. Like she'd kept all this, these drawings of her journey, and I was like, that's what Rapunzel would do. She would keep she's very creative, she's very much a storyteller, and that's how she would do it. So we immediately said, well, let's give Rapunzel a journal that she can keep record of her, because she's so creative, she's going to want to paint on the road.
Now, did you ever draw your experiences like that?
Well, you know what? I didn't like journal experiences, but whenever, like as a kid, whenever I'd see something, a movie that was set in a historical time period, or I'd watch the Oscars and see, you know, all these beautiful dresses, I would just be drawn to my drawing paper and have to like draw out like fashion dresses that were in my head, or like from movies, I would draw out like the characters and things like that. So anything creative would spark my creativity and I just have to get it out on paper.
Some things never change.
I know. Yeah.
Either it's drawing or podcasting. Mm-hmm. You're very creative, just yes. like Rapunzel.
Oh, yay. Now, in this journal that we're talking about that Rapunzel is given, it has an inscription. Plus est-ce vous? I have no idea how to say that. And I say it in the movie and I still don't know how to say it. But
I flunked French in ninth grade, so don't even look at me for that. So that's why they gave us a journal as
yes.
swag.
Yeah, as swag. Yeah.
They didn't gave put us, that one together.
They gave us a journal and they gave us this bag, which has the phrase here in French. And then thankfully, it has the phrase in English too, which means there is more in you. Thank goodness. So some of the bloggers, they asked about the deeper meaning behind that phrase.
We gave her this journal, and then the added element of the inscription came very much from the movie. Glenn Keane, who created... the character of Rapunzel for the film, had come, and I was talking to him about what we wanted to do with the show, and he had done this quick drawing for me. I said, give me a drawing that's going to encourage me years as we go into the show. And he had done this picture, this beautiful drawing of Rapunzel, and on it he wrote Plus en vous. And I was like, what is that? He said, well, in the movie we had this phrase that we were using just in the story rooms of like, you know, at the end of the movie, all of her magic is gone, but she squeezes out one last drop of magic out of her. And he said the reason behind that, the meaning behind that, is that we all have more in us that we can push through. And he was telling me, like, when you feel like you're at the end of your ropes, if you can't give any more, push through, and there's always more inside of you. And I thought that was such a beautiful sentiment. And I thought that the mother would give it to Rapunzel as, like, listen, everybody has these expectations of you, of a princess, of a daughter, of a girlfriend, but there's more in you than everybody else has expected of you, and show the world what that is, and keep record of that in this journal. So the phrase means there's more in everybody. There's more inside of Eugene. There's more inside of Pascal. There's more inside of Corona than everybody just sees on the surface. You know, we're going to get into as we go into the season, there's even like tunnels underneath Corona. And even the tunnels have that thing that blew us. There's more in Corona. Like, we try and put that in every aspect. So the journal's very much a part of the large story for the show and for who Rapunzel is.
Now, to me, this is really telling me that the creators sat down, really thought about the overall arc of the show through from the beginning, the middle, and the end, much like Dave Filoni does with Star Wars Rebels and Clone Wars. So are you seeing these similarities too?
Yeah, well, every show has got a story Bible.
Mm-hmm.
Which
starts
from the beginning to the very end.
Right.
That way they're not just writing haphazardly and writing themselves into corners. They have this Bible, then they'll know what direction the show is going to go. Of course, it's always going to veer left and right, but if they have a beginning and the ending with a lot of plot points, mm-hmm. makes it so much easier for the writers.
Okay.
Well, it sounds like from our scope walkers and our face huggers, mm-hmm. there's a lot of Tangled fans out there who are eager to see this new series.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, you know what? We've talked about the story a lot, so now it was time, Richard, mm-hmm. you got to ask your amazing question.
Yeah, one of the questions I had going in was about the design, because the design of the series did not match the design of the movie, just like the Clone Wars had such a distinct design that did not match anything else. It worked perfectly, and they were going for a certain feel. But this one here, since the design was already established with the film, I really wondered why they had departed from that original look.
The design style is much different than in the movie. What was the inspiration for the design for the series?
one of the things that Chris and I both come from, old school, traditional 2D Disney background. Both of us started a little over 20 years ago. And so just our passion for that feeling of like a good Disney traditional animated film really, I think, drove us early on to be like, hey, man, we got an opportunity to push that side of it. And then from like a, just from a bigger story point, we really sat down and we were like, if this is Rapunzel telling her story, by the time this whole series is over, this should really feel like Rapunzel told us her story. And how would she tell us that story? She's not going to sit down in you know, computer programs and be typing zeros and ones and getting mathematical equations down for a rig. She's going to sit down and put her hand and actually do it herself. So we really kind of embraced the whole ideological side of doing a 2D, you know, series, and where we put in everything where there's little brush strokes, like dry brush strokes in that should feel like she painted it. The lines that surround everything and inside, we use a very rough line quality to really give a tactile sense of sketching. We lay off gradient, like bare computer Photoshop-y gradients as much as possible. There's they pop up here and there, but we kind of stay away in place of feeling like it really feels like a storybook come to life. Just because we really want to make it feel like she is the person that's telling you this story.
It almost looks like it has a little bit of an inspiration from George Lucas's film Twice Upon a Time.
Oh my gosh, that's a high praise indeed. Yeah, that thing is amazing. Yeah.
I want to see some Easter eggs for Twice Upon a Time.
Maybe they'll put them in now.
I hope they do. That would be awesome. A very underseen George Lucas film.
You know what? I've never seen it.
You know what? We will now.
Okay. So
we will now.
Is it animated then?
It's animated. It's 2D animated.
See, I totally didn't know
and
this.
And the style reflects this, the Tangled series.
Okay. Wow. Well, that was a great question.
Thank you.
And then another blogger brought it to the music. We actually had some great questions. All of us bloggers like really touched on everything. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, Alan Menken, he is back writing songs for Tangled the series, which I just think is amazing. So let's get into some details about the music.
We heard two new songs that came from this this particular episode. Will we hear new songs in every episode moving forward? And if so, will there be a DVD, you know, songs?
Yeah, a soundtrack, sure. Soundtrack. So, you know, again, Ben said we come from old school Disney. Part of that is, you know, me being very much influenced by the works of Howard Ashman and Alan Menken, you know. And Howard Ashman had given this wonderful lecture many years ago when they were making Little Mermaid that I got to just see on video, and where he talks about music and its role in storytelling and how it should really be, if it's the most successful, it's really telling the heart of a character and really or changing the heart of a character. So we really wanted to keep the music special. We knew our access to Alan Menken was going to be limited, and even if we had unlimited access to Alan Menken, getting a song into every episode, not only is it productionally very difficult because it's so much time for a music, you don't want to cheat it and it takes up so much time, but I wanted the music to stay special. I wanted it to be used where the characters have something to say and have something on their heart that is going to change their viewpoint on the world. And so those big moments lined up with what we're calling our tent poles. So we have three big tent poles per season. So we have a season premiere, a mid-season, and a season finale. And those are the places where we really have the big musical moments where huge things happen. And when I say big things happen, there are going to be times when that's really kind of like spoilery. So we didn't want to put a soundtrack out in the beginning because it was going to give away a lot of the huge moments of the season. So people are certainly going to want, trust me, the music is awesome. And there's more music to come, and it is epic and big and special, and people are definitely going to want it. But the collection really makes sense at the end of the season where you really see the whole thing kind of come together.
So based on their answer, I understand their reasoning for not putting music in every episode, but honestly, I kind of was expecting that. If you watch Sophia the First, every episode has like a tentpole song for each episode, and they're really cute. And
yeah.
Like it comes, and you know, you get the series CD, and it's like all the songs, and most of them upbeat and spiffy. Like it's great. So
do you know what TV series created that mass cross-marketing technique?
The monkeys?
The monkeys.
How did I know?
Their show was a big commercial for their albums.
Oh, okay.
Because they would air two or three songs per episode.
Huh.
So I figured with Tangled and any other Disney show, they would want to cross-promote and have as many songs as they can fit in there because
yeah.
the more songs that are released, the more albums they can sell.
Exactly. But like he said, you know, Alan Menken, they don't have unlimited access to him. He's a pretty busy guy.
Yeah, that's true.
So as long as these songs count, and it sounds like they will, they'll be used as a turning point for characters. So maybe the album will have more meaning then.
Okay.
Instead of just patter songs or something. So.
Or maybe Michael Giacchino can come on in and fill in.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, the Q&A continued on, and this next question really brings up an aspect I love about social media now, and that is that we can follow our favorite celebrities or actors or directors or producers or podcasters and interact with them on social media. So I think that's great. And Chris Sonnenberg has a particularly fun Instagram account.
I have an Instagram account, Follow Pascal. So yeah. you can either go to Follow Pascal on Instagram or hashtag Follow Pascal if you get a picture of him, where we take him, this guy, he's in my bag right now, he'll come out in a second, but he goes with us to all of the records and all of the events we do with you guys. He's been there with every single celebrity that we get for the show. And as those characters come up during that week, I'll put up the picture that we had of either, you know, whatever the special guest of the week is. So you'll be able to see Pascal. That's him. I only have one.
Yeah.
And he goes with me everywhere. And you'll be able to see the fun things that different celebrities have done with him.
That's so fun.
I'm so excited. So it sounds like Chris Sonnenberg will be posting after each episode or during each episode of Tangled, the series as it airs, he'll post a picture of Pascal with something that is pertinent to that episode.
Nice.
I will be following that Instagram account.
So cute.
I know. All right. Now, Lady Kane is a new character in Tangled, the series, and she's kind of the baddie of the movie. So she has a tattoo.
Yeah.
I know. So one blogger did ask about that, and it turned into a great discussion on the animation of the series.
Will we see Lady Kane again, and what was behind giving her a tattoo?
Well, I'll just say, tune in for the answer to
those. Well, I don't know. I mean, even with the tattoo and stuff like that, I mean, I think it was just literally one of the cool things about the program we're using, it's called Harmony, is it's sort of this blend between doing CG and 2D. I mean, technically what we're doing is we're building like all of these characters in the computer by flat images that end up spinning around. So in traditional 2D animation, you could never, ever get away with that detailed tattoo. You'd kill somebody by them having to draw it 10 billion times. But in the computer, we can actually just plant it on there and have it spin around. So some of it's just a little bit of us as designers on the show being able to get in with some cool little nitty-gritty details
but
and stuff
definitely
like that.
Gets,
and
but are there,
and yeah. then it's, as from a character standpoint, too, I mean, it's like...
No.
But as a tattoo and stuff like that, I mean, it definitely says something about a personality. And for Lady Kane, I mean, she's got a skull and I believe it's roses and
yes.
stuff like that on there, which just kind of helps sell some of the idea of her personality in the show being a little bit edgy, but also there being an understory there that comes from a real hurt that she went through as a child. And I think that tattoo, you know, if we're going to do something like that, we aren't just going to randomly...
Yeah.
Or throw something evil on there because she looks evil. There, we try to think of the meaning.
But there's
it.
No other female Disney character that has a tattoo. Would this be the first one? I can recall.
We certainly didn't set out to be the first, and I would. I don't know. I gotta imagine there has to have been.
Is there really no other one? Wow.
Right about that.
Well,
oh no! Wait a minute. Pocahontas has got a tattoo.
Yeah. Does she?
Oh yeah. I had to draw that tattoo. No, I'll tell you a quick story. They put that on late on her, and so we had to go back and draw that.
Oh.
And it had all these little tiny spikes with dots at the bottom of them.
I was going to point out sometimes where it fluctuates a little in the frames.
It's my fault.
You ruined the movie
Thanks
for me
a lot. But that's 1994. That's a long time ago.
So that was funny. He created Pocahontas with the tattoo, and he forgot about it.
I didn't know that that was a tattoo on Pocahontas' arm. I thought it was just like an armband.
Me too. I thought it was an armband as well. What do you guys think? Does Pocahontas have a tattoo? I guess she does have a tattoo, because that's what they said. But did you think it was a tattoo, or did you think it was an armband? Well, I really liked what Ben said about the computer program. I mean, dabbling in that stuff myself, it really, I love that. So I find it fascinating that now to create 2D animation, they are still using a 3D type program. And it makes a lot of sense in terms of making the process faster to animate.
Now, which one of these guys worked on Beavis and Butthead?
Oh, I think that was Ben.
That was Ben?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So he's used to working in that 2D style.
Yeah.
And I just wanted a reason to bring up Beavis and Butthead. I think for the first time ever on Skywalking through Neverland.
First and only. All right. But Ben Balistrieri, he does actually have an Instagram account, and he does share his artwork, which does actually look a little Beavis and Butthead-y. I mean, not quite as rudimentary, but like he does have that style a little bit, like the crazy, like stretched out characters, or you know, stretched or squished characters. Mm-hmm.
Can we do a Beavis and Butthead segment every week now?
No, you can't.
Okay, just asking.
All right. Well, the next question is about Cassandra, which is Rapunzel's lady in waiting and confidant on the show.
Can we talk about the new character Cassandra and her role and the history behind her?
Well, of course, I'm going to go back to the same thing I've been saying over and over again. There's always the why. Why does Cassandra exist? Why on every level? Cassandra kind of came to be two ways. Number one, in my head, and then number two, three, sort of mine, the writers, and then when Eden Espinosa came. You know, when Eden came to voice her, she gave her another level that we could have never written. Like, Eden is very much who Cassandra is. She's very tough. She's very vocal. I don't know if you guys follow her on Instagram or anything, but she's a real tough lady. I love her to death. But you know, it started to become evident as to who Cassandra was going to be when you asked the question, who does Rapunzel need in her life? And I felt like she needed somebody that had access to the castle, that had a very adventurous spirit, much like herself, somebody that Rapunzel could kind of look up to. And if Cassandra, you know, as an idea, was somebody that was going to have access to Rapunzel, it had to be somebody that was very close to her on a daily basis. So that's why we gave it to being somebody like a lady in waiting. But ultimately, she is somebody that Rapunzel can confide in and really share things with, that, like a girlfriend, like my friends, like again, my daughters have friends that they talk to in different ways than they talk to. You know, the guys in their lives, or me and my wife, and we wanted to give Rapunzel somebody like that. And she just, you know, as we were writing the first few episodes and kind of coming up with the concept of the show, her character almost like wrote herself. Like, she was very militaristic, and again, like, she, because her father was the captain of the guards, she had a very different way, whereas Rapunzel's this kind of like free-thinking hippie. She's much more militaristic, much more like on, we gotta get going, da-da-da-da, and, you know, and it just makes for fun storytelling when you have somebody on one side of an opinion and somebody on the other side.
Yeah, storytelling's all about contrast, and so when you have two really diametrically opposed viewpoints on the same issue, it just becomes fun storytelling. So Rapunzel, who's always so optimistic and so cheerful and so full of wonder at everything she meets, it's great to have the opposite view, which is a little more sarcastic and a little more down to earth, and you get that different take on the same topic. It just makes for really great storytelling.
And I love being able to hear Mandy, and again, Mandy and Eden together, they're such great performances. And again, as we start to hear them, we start writing them in very specific ways. So it's a really cool relationship, and I think one that evolves really, really naturally as well.
I love their description about what Cassandra's role in Tangled is going to be and how it's going to be opposite of Rapunzel.
Right. Yeah. And the fact that they have different backgrounds, kind of, they can really play off each other and learn from each other that way.
Cassandra is so worldly. Mm-hmm. She knows the world outside of the window that Rapunzel keeps looking out of, but she wants Rapunzel to grow.
Right.
She wants her to get out there and see the world, because as you know, if you're just stuck to a castle, to a
tower,
we have no reference points to anything.
Mm-hmm.
Now, one of the questions I had, because when I was watching the film, my eye was going everywhere looking for the hidden treasures. Oh. So, of course, I had to ask a question about Easter eggs.
Disney is known for their Easter eggs. Were there any Easter eggs in this episode?
You'll have to...
I didn't see any. Are they that well hidden?
Easter eggs, if you saw them right after the thing. My aunt used to always, when we go over to her house for Easter, would put the big one out in the front, and then, you know, we don't have any big Easter eggs. The ones that you have to have the money in them are hidden way inside the piano. So you got to really look and wait for them to come out. There's one in there, I'll tell you. There's one, and it's more of a personal one. Well, Ariana, my daughter, being the queen, that's a kind of an personal Easter egg. My family crest is it's interesting. Sonnenberg means sunny castle. And the crest for the Sonnenberg crest is a hill with a castle on it. And I always think it's interesting that Corona is a hill with a castle on it. So we put that crest on one of the flags in the kingdom is my family crest. So more of a personal Easter egg, but well, there's certainly other fun Disney ones, but you gotta keep a keen eye open.
There are a lot of very specific references to the feature, like very, very specific, like to the point of if there's a book, you know, we researched a book that happened to be in the movie specifically and tried to at least caricature it in our style.
I don't think that's going to be a really hard one. I'll tell you guys this one, and you really don't see it until the first actual episode. So we have our Disney Channel original movie, and then 2 weeks later we'll have our show start. And the opening sequence, if you guys will keep your eye open for that, there are a couple in there that you guys can keep an eye open for.
Yeah. I love the fact that there are lots of Easter eggs, but they're more personal Easter eggs.
Yeah.
That's so sweet.
Queen Ariana. Ariana is his daughter.
Right. Like, in his family crest.
Yeah.
That's fantastic.
How cool is that? Sonnenberg, sunny castle. Like, that's a great crest. I love that.
Yeah. But as sweet as that is, I still want to see some Disney Easter eggs.
Okay.
Within each episode.
Oh, all right. Well, it sounds like Tangled fans will see a lot of Easter eggs.
Yeah. You know what? We should develop a series called Easter Eggs.
And
I don't know where I'm going with that.
Have Hoojibs in it?
Yeah. Oh, hold on. I'm seeing a celebration game called Easter Eggs.
Uh-oh.
All right. Way off track.
Okay.
Okay. Let's come back around.
Let's come back to a really important question.
So what are you most proud of about continuing Rapunzel's story?
Oh, man. For me, just honoring the original. It's always been a huge priority of mine to not only honor the work that was laid out by Nathan and Byron on the original film, and Glenn Keane, who created the character, not only honor that, but keep true to the characters. That was always my marching orders from Glenn Keane, who created the character. It was always just be true to who she is, and I think we've done a really good job of that. Do you have anything that you...
I mean, that goes hand in hand with, I think both of us are on the exact same mission statement that way, which is just to, I mean, we have not only do we have friends that have worked on these features, we've also been in situations where we've worked on features that have been translated, and you just have such a passion for not only for the filmmakers, but how many fans there are of Tangled. I mean, Tangled is an insane property. And the people, like, I go on Tumblr or... you know, even on Facebook and see comments and stuff, or on YouTube and see comments, and you're just like, man, these people love these characters. We have like a duty to make sure that we're doing right by these characters for these people that are going to, you know, that live and love these characters so much. That it's an awesome responsibility.
I'm one of those. I'm like, don't mess this up. Don't
do. Yeah. We're right there with you. We are right there with you.
Yeah.
All right, knowing how much they love Tangled and how much care they are taking with Tangled, I am really excited to see this series play out. What about you?
Oh, very much so. Very, very much so. And seeing how much you love Tangled and how happy it makes you, I'm just so happy it comes out on your birthday. And I'm glad they got the cast back.
Ugh.
So, yeah, this is just a recipe for success.
Yes, and like... You probably wouldn't watch this series, would you?
No.
If not from... No. No. Okay.
No.
But you'll watch it with me?
Oh, of course. Of course. And I say no just because you have that connection to Rapunzel with the blonde hair.
Right.
I don't really have a connection with Tangled because I don't have that smoldering look that Flynn has. But it's like a lot of stuff. I wouldn't know anything of country music if I had not heard you play it. And like, oh, okay, now I've got more of an ear for it.
Okay.
So it's other people in your life that bring these new experiences. Like we were saying earlier, just you got to look outside your window for a new opening, something that's right there. But you don't know it until someone says, hey, take a look at this.
Aw.
So yeah, I will be watching this with you.
Okay, well, great. Well, bringing it back to the event of the day, the Q&A ended, and Chris Sonnenberg wanted to take a group photo with his Pascal for his @followPascal Instagram account. So look for that. He hasn't posted it as of now, but I'm hoping he will.
Yeah, and he was saying that if you look in, on his account, you'll see how many celebrities that Pascal has been with.
Yeah, and of course, there's Zachary Levi is there. Pascal was taken to the premiere of the series. So it was really neat. So it's really fun to follow that account. And we got to take individual pictures with Chris and Ben and Pascal. Mm-hmm. And I put him on my shoulder and I was wearing my Rapunzel shirt.
Oh, they loved you.
Yeah.
You were a walking billboard.
I know. Oh, it was great. So, oh, yes.
Oh, so I was going to say, then right after we had walked out and saw all these swag bags and waited around just to make sure that we were one of the recipients of these of these swag bags. And a couple of minutes later, who comes walking out but
Chris and Ben.
Yeah.
Chris and Ben walk out and they were kind of on to their next thing, but we're not going very fast. So you got to say that.
I told them, you guys planned this right around Sarah's birthday, didn't you? And after a couple of seconds of silence, they said, yes. Yes, we did.
Yes.
And had a great conversation with these guys. And I love hearing their enthusiasm and such respect for the source material.
Yeah. And upon hearing that it was my birthday, the day that Tangled Ever After premieres, Ben asked if we had a pen and a piece of paper. And I was like, well, right here. I gave it to him and he began to draw.
Yeah.
Oh, and he drew a Pascal. Oh, my goodness. Yeah, little so Pascal face.
We're showing the scope walkers and the face huggers right now this picture. You did post that, right, online?
I did. I posted it all over our account. So
a picture of Pascal's head. What does it say there?
It says, happy birthday, Sarah. And he signed it Ben 17, so 2017. It's so cute. I'm so excited. And you can bet this will be going up on my new studio wall, along with probably the poster here. This Tangled Before Ever After series poster. So that was exciting. And while Ben was drawing that, I asked Chris Sonnenberg a question that was, you know, in the back of my head during the press conference in case I got to ask another question. And that was, how did most of the original cast and crew, including Mandy Moore and Zachary Levi and Alan Menken, sign on for the show? Like, how did that happen? And
they said very quickly.
Well, it was interesting what he said, because I thought maybe, I don't know what I thought it would be, but Chris said that when he went to them to tell them about the new TV series, they were all very protective of the characters. They're like, wait, what do you want to do? And where is this going to go? And how is their personalities going to be represented? They wanted to make sure that the characters and the story was being upheld correctly. So,
well, and Zachary Levi, being a big pop culturist, he wanted to make sure that everything was going to stay true to Flynn Rider.
Yeah.
And he wanted to make sure that everything was in sync and they weren't going to do something that was totally off-brand for Rapunzel and Tangled. So kudos to him. I don't know if he's looking for a producer credit or what. But, you know, I'm so appreciative when actors take that such a vested interest in their characters and the show itself.
Yeah. So we didn't get to record that question, but we're relaying it for you. Was there anything else you remember? Because I know when you're asking a question and you're in the moment and, like, Ben was drawing me the picture, do you remember anything else?
Yeah, I asked them if they validate parking.
Oh.
They said yes.
Yes.
So we got our swag bags and we were on our way.
Yes.
So it was a great day. Mm-hmm. Fantastic day. And Sarah, once again, how would you define this day?
Best day ever!
So once again, Tangled Before Ever After premieres on Disney Channel March the 10th. Followed by Tangled the Series on March the 24th. Also on Disney Channel.
I'll be wearing my jammies, and I'll have Pascal, and I'll have my my Rapunzel doll, and I'll be watching.
Shout outs, Skywalker, shout outs. Which Skywalkers get props from here in Neverland? Who was tweeted out? Shout out. Who was photoballed? Shout out. Who was shared a post? Shout out.
Right. Shout out to all of you Skywalkers, because there is a Twitter giveaway going on right now at Skywalking Pod. You could win an Ahsoka versus Vader lithograph from the season 2 finale of Star Wars Rebels. It is beautiful. It is one of only 500, and it is a very coveted item. So far, we are up to 413 retweets.
Goodness gracious.
I know.
Just coming into the Twitter universe myself.
Yes.
How many is average for a retweet?
Average on our episode retweets is about, I would say, 25 or so.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah. 25, 30, something like that. Thank you, Skywalkers, of course, for doing that. So if you want to enter to win that lithograph and you have not already, simply head to Twitter and find the tweet of that. And I'll probably have it pinned on our Twitter page. And just retweet and make sure you're following at Skywalking Pod, because we will check.
All right. And Joey just suggested we do a hashtag STN Tangled Talk thread every week.
In our Facebook group.
Yeah.
Well, that is a great idea. We do a talk for the Tangled, the series.
Mm-hmm.
I like that. I like that idea.
And Jeremy Hunt brought up we do a hashtag for Celebration Orlando,
yes,
which will be STNCO.
Yeah.
Hashtag STNCO.
Yes.
Skywalking through Neverland, Celebration Orlando.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
Yes.
And it's short, so you can fit it in with your SWCO hashtag as well as what you want to say. And that's a good way for us Skywalkers to kind of know where each other is in this giant convention center as this is all happening. So what a great idea for Jeremy Hunt and all of our Skywalkers who immediately decided, oh my gosh, that's amazing. So follow that hashtag, STNCO. All right, now, Richard.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking of Twitter,
mm-hmm,
you have been tweeting a lot more,
mm-hmm,
and we both have fun live tweeting to Star Wars Rebels episodes. Yay!
You're having a lot of fun doing that.
You are. So if you want to talk the music, I'm tweeting at Jedi Tink. And for some great nostalgia connections, I noticed you tweet that a lot, which is great. And then, of course, at Skywalking Pod live tweets as well. That's usually me. But sometimes it's Richard. And we had some great responses to our live tweet of Secret Cargo, the latest Star Wars Rebels episode. So I tweeted at Skywalking Pod, okay, who else got all teary-eyed as all those ships started to show up at the end of the episode? And several of you responded. So at Connie she wrote, I also felt a bit of deja vu. Mon's broadcast above Dantooine reminded me of Ezra's broadcast from Lothal in season 1.
Oh, yeah.
I love when the Skywalkers bring stuff up like that.
You know what it reminded me of?
What?
The scene in Witness.
Oh.
The great Harrison Ford movie, where at the end, the little boy, Lucas Haas, is ringing the bell to call all the other Amish folks and farmers in the area to come running, because that's the help signal.
Yeah, that's right.
And all the neighbors and all the farmers all come to the aid of the
Harrison
this family
Ford
that needs help.
Right.
So I know back when I saw it when I was 15 years old, I got a little misty-eyed.
Oh.
I love when communities band together the way these rebel cells all banded together for one goal.
I love that.
So it reminded me of Witness.
Well, a lot of you chimed in to this moment, and Christopher Marino at Mental Madness, he said, it was awesome and had the picture of that moment ready to go. So thank you, Chris. We were able to share that picture. At Silent Movie Girl, who is Alicia LaHoye, she said, I totally did. Got teary-eyed. Glad it wasn't just me. And Doug Brooks, who is at Desert Vol, he says, raise his hand. It took me back to my emotions during the Battle of Scarif, which actually it did for me too. Like seeing all those ships that you eventually see over the Battle of Scarif, I was like, ooh, reminds me of that. It's
and really one of cool. The things that both of us tweeted at the same time is we need to see this on the big screen.
Yes.
When will we be able to do that?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, just seeing that nebula and everything. Like, it was gorgeous.
Oh, just the nebula scene alone I want to see on the big screen.
Yeah, and a lot of you responded to that and retweeted that comment. Like, we need to see Star Wars Rebels on the big screen. So please, tweet at Dave Filoni, tweet at Tracy Canobio, tweet at any of the Star Wars people involved with Star Wars Rebels and just say, hey, we want to see this on the big screen. Perhaps they will make it happen. All right, Skywalkers. So some of you have already bought our new Star Wars Celebration Orlando design, which is super exciting. It's all new for Star Wars Celebration. And even if you're not going to Star Wars Celebration, you will be able to order this design until Star Wars Celebration at our Tee Public store. So those items that you bought are starting to come in, and all of our Skywalkers are sharing pictures of what they ordered. It's super cool. So at Connie Shi, she shared a picture of the teal t-shirt and said, hashtag SWCO t-shirt arrived in the mail today. Love seeing the new design up close.
Yeah.
It's super cool.
Yeah, the Mandervillians.
Yes.
Also tweeted out a picture.
Mm-hmm.
David and Luann Manderville.
They were the very first ones to tweet about that. And it's just super cool to seeing it like live.
Yeah. Yeah. And they got matching shirts. That was so cute.
I know.
All right, with that, what do you say we reveal this week's Skywalker of the week?
Will Magalio.
Congratulations, Will! We want to thank you so much for sharing the show every week, sharing our show around Facebook and things, like in different groups and stuff.
And normally you're on Facebook or Periscope, and we're so glad right now you're not.
Yeah. So,
do you want to ruin the surprise?
It's a surprise for you.
Yes.
So once again, your jingle is amazing and has been composed by Rob Dellinger,
the John Williams of podcasting.
And Rob, he is amazing. He's working on something special for Star Wars Celebration.
Mm-hmm. All we're going to say.
Yes. And we just want to thank him so much. And Skywalkers, we do have an album available, and that helps support Rob Dellinger in his compositions. Like, he's amazing. And the album is called Skywalking Through Neverland, Awesome Jingle Mix, Volume 1, and it can be downloaded on iTunes or anywhere you can get downloadable music. All right, Skywalkers, you can become Skywalker of the Week by sharing a tweet of the episode in a fun and positive way. Also, you can comment on an episode on Facebook or Twitter.
It's going to really up your chance if you write an iTunes review.
Oh, that's right. And so iTunes?
Hit iTunes.
Okay,
not
that's
just one
right.
Tune. It's plural, iTunes.
Oh. That's true. You know, we haven't checked iTunes lately, so next week we're going to check.
Yes.
All right. All right, Skywalkers. Well, thank you for joining us for Skywalker Shoutouts. And now it's time for a Skywalker story.
Skywalker story. Stories.
Wherever your fandom lies, chances are you have a story to tell.
Today on Skywalker Stories, we have Amanda Bond and Gabriel Colbaugh.
Hey, Amanda and Gabriel.
Hey, Richard and Sarah.
Hey.
Hey, thanks for coming on Skywalker Stories and telling your stories. So, what are you going to share with us?
Back in September, as part of Saber Guild, which is a Lucasfilm recognized costuming club that Amanda and I belong to, we went to perform before a special Mark Hamill panel at Salt Lake Comic Con.
That is so cool. I saw some of your pictures of this, so I am so excited to hear more of this story.
Well, it's pretty funny. About a week before we headed up, because we'd actually been there last year, Saber Guild had been invited, and because our Las Vegas temple was the newest one and the closest one, we ended up going up last year and performing a bunch of shows in their KidsCon area, and so they wanted us back this year. And about a week before we headed up, I get a message from some of our people up in Utah going, hey, could you do a short, like 1 to 2 minute demo in front of the Mark Hamill panel?
Wow.
And the big thing about the Mark Hamill panel was it was his only North American convention appearance. And so because there are so many people that are interested in have it, instead of having it in their normal ballroom, which does seat a few thousand people, they decided to work with the city to be able to get into the basketball arena that was just down the road from the convention center. And so they were looking to have between 15 and 20,000 people at the panel.
I would like to point out that we did not know that it was 15 to 20,000 people when we said, yeah, we can do this, no problem.
Wow.
Is this your first time performing in front of that many people?
We'd also done the local minor league baseball team. We did a performance during the seventh inning stretch, and we had about 11,000 people in that stadium. So this was the next step up from that. So it was interesting, to say the least.
It was my first time. I didn't get to do the baseball event. So when they said there was 15,000 people, it was it got very real very quickly. Let me put it that way.
Was this right before you went on that they said, oh, by the way, there's 15 plus people?
Or did you just go out 15,000? And go, oh, I thought there'd be like 300 people here.
Well, we knew that it was going to be that they had moved it to the arena and that they expected a large crowd. But 15,000 is one of those words that until you see people in that many seats in the arena and the Jumbotron, you don't really have a feeling, at least I didn't, of what that was going to feel like. I mean, maybe your experience is different, Gabe, because you perform for the minor league team.
I wouldn't say it was that much different. I just really, really focused on the fact that there was a show that I had to do and who my fight partner was. So that way I wouldn't get freaked out by the fact that there were indeed 15,000 people there. And that helped a lot.
After the first 13,000, the rest is just a number.
Exactly.
All right. So you go on and then what happens? How did the show go?
Well, they started out, they had their two warm-up guys who were out there, and they were, the whole thing was, you know, light side versus dark side and try and get it hyped up. And we go out there, and one of our members does Count Dooku. Mm. He's a 26-year-old kid who gets transformed to look like an 80-year-old man.
Wow.
And does so quite effectively. So we're up there and we're performing, and because we have Count Dooku, who's a face character, there are certain rules that we follow just because we try and keep it as close to the movies as possible in a way. So like the only person who could really, you know, truly defeat Count Dooku is Anakin, even though, you know, he could cause him to run away and stuff like that. So we'd planned it where the dark side would win, at least with our fight. And we took some choreography that we'd been working on. And Amanda was in one fight, and I was in the other with the guy who was doing Count Dooku. And went through it, and about 60 to 90 seconds later, I don't really remember. It was kind of a blur. Finished it off with a force choke from Count Dooku, and the crowd went wild.
Oh, wow. At some point, did you give Mark Hamill a lightsaber and say, if you want to join us, feel free?
I wish. He unfortunately wasn't quite there yet by the time they had us go on.
Oh, no.
Yeah, that was one of the funny things is that we were actually, since we were the pre-show entertainment, they kept saying, oh, Mark Hamill is on his way. Mark Hamill is in the building. And they would do for a warm-up, like, Mark Hamill can hear you, make some noise. And they did this quite a bit. Mark Hamill can hear you, make some noise. So it's still a joke with our group where we say, Mark Hamill can still hear you, you know. Yeah, I wish. We actually had a special seating area that wasn't all that close. But one of our members, who shall remain nameless to protect him, he actually managed to stay right down by the stage. Since Mark Hamill was a personal childhood hero of his, like he grew up wanting to be Luke Skywalker.
Right.
After our performance, he just kind of slipped to the side of the stage. And evidently Mark Hamill got within like 8 feet of him.
You know, that's how it's done.
Absolutely.
You just push that big red button.
You take those moments when you can get them.
Did Mark Hamill happen to see any of your show?
I don't think so, unfortunately, unless someone showed him the video of everything afterwards. But, you know, in lieu of that, the crowd was really pumped by what we did, and we got a pretty sizable cheer. So we take that as a definite consolation, knowing that what we did was appreciated by a lot of people.
Yeah, hyped everyone up to see Mark Hamill himself.
Oh, yeah.
That's amazing.
And what better way than a big lightsaber battle? Is there a storyline to your show?
That particular one was kind of, it was a small part of a greater storyline and a greater show we have. We call it our Prime Fight because it was the first one we ever really built where it was tied to the youngling training that we did for the Kids Con, which is kind of similar to the Lightsaber Academy stuff that they have at Disneyland,
right,
where we do this whole routine where the Jedi are training the kids and then the bad guys show up and they interfere with the training and they try and take the kids away to be their apprentices instead, and the Jedi have to step in and stop them and get the kids help in order to be able to do so. For that particular part, it was really just pretty much, hey, let's go out there and fight, so that way we could just move it along.
Right.
And do you have Jedi names?
Yeah, actually. That one, I've got a couple, but for that one, I was Jedi Master Gideon Kenobi. No relation to Obi-Wan.
Yeah, that joke gets made. And I play Jedi Knight Zophie Drisk. She's a Zabrak. I actually have Zabrak horns I wear.
Oh, cool.
And this wig so I can have like horns sticking up.
Oh, nice.
And the secret of our shows is I usually die first.
Oh, no.
Mostly because...
You need a better agent.
Mostly because when I started out, I had the least amount of experience, but they wanted to get me on stage, so I had the least number of counts to learn.
Okay.
So I'm usually either starting the fight or dying first, one of the two.
Oh, my goodness.
Sometimes both.
How much rehearsals do you do for these lightsaber shows?
At least once a week. It's actually built in the Saber Guild charter. It's why Lucasfilm lets us do the lightsaber performances, as we're willing to put in the once a week practices, though we usually do twice a week, at least here in Vegas, just to make sure that we have some time for basic training stuff and then some time set aside specifically for working on new fights and new choreography.
Did they ever come by to do any kind of spot checking?
Lucasfilm, no. They pretty much leave us to it and just trust us not to do anything that might reflect poorly on them.
We do put in our choreography, though, to the National Council, just to have it spot check.
Yeah. Sal Perales and his family are members of Temple Prime down in Orange County, and you've actually met our global director, Rob, who's the big guy with the weird yellow contacts that shows up some screenings.
Yeah, Rob Yanagihara.
Yep, that's him.
Yeah, we see him everywhere.
Yeah.
Awesome. It's one of the benefits of being part of a Lucasfilm costume group. Sometimes they let you in on the cool stuff.
Absolutely.
Nice. Where can people see you guys next?
We don't have a ton planned, but we are going to be out at Celebration. And if it all goes like how it was in Anaheim, each of the different temples we have will be given a slot to do some performance time, usually about a 15 to 30 minute show, depending on how many people come along and things like that. So that'd be a great place to check out not only what our temple can do, but what a lot of other temples can do.
Wow, that sounds amazing. That sounds like so much fun. If only we had some more time to participate. That'd be. I used to do something like that with a friend of mine, Lou Klein, and we would have so much fun just choreographing our own lightsaber battles or recreating the Obi-Wan versus Darth Maul battle.
Wow!
So I know how much fun that can be, and it's such great exercise too.
Well, oh, it is. I get pretty sweaty after practice. It's between running for Disney run events and Saber Guild training. That's pretty much my workouts. Who needs a gym when you have Star Wars and Disney, right?
Right. Awesome.
Oh, I sense a new theme for a new gym.
Exactly. But let's keep it under the radar.
Okay.
At least until you get the business plan together, right?
Right. Exactly. All right, guys. Well, where can people find you on social media?
Our Facebook page is the easiest place to get a hold of us for Saber Guild, which is, of course, facebook.com/SGNARSHADDA, N-A-R-S-H-A-D-D-A-A, which is the Smuggler Moon We figured that worked for Vegas, considering the fact that, you know, it is kind of the Las Vegas Star Wars. Mm-hmm. You can also find me personally at Marshall Gabe on Twitter, though I don't tweet a whole lot, more so much as respond to people.
Okay. And I'm on Twitter as Werewolf Cowgirl. But if you're interested in Saber Guild, you can also go to saberguild.org. And there are temples all over the country and the world that you can join. So you don't have to be in Las Vegas to join.
Awesome. And I know that you both are on the Skywalking Through Neverland Facebook group as well.
Oh, yeah. I love that place for its positivity, as well as all the fun of being able to have a place to post Star Wars and Disney and even some Harry Potter stuff.
Definitely.
Well, it's great to have you in the Skywalker family.
Aw, thanks. We're happy to be a part of it.
Well, Amanda and Gabriel, thank you very much for sharing your Skywalker stories with us and the Skywalkers.
Glad to do it.
Thanks, guys.
As a young boy in Marshalline, Missouri, Walt Disney played Peter Pan in one of his favorite stories in a school play. He used to say in Disneyland, an adult is just a grown-up child. Well, here at the Neverland Podcast, we'll talk about heroes like Spider-Man, He-Man, and others that taught us how to do what's right, because right makes might. We're like Saturday mornings all in one podcast. Join us every week to go to Disney and beyond at NeverlandPodcast.com.
You're the busiest bee in the fan community. You get around the galaxy enthusiastically. You're 0.5 past light speed.
It's almost impossible to imagine that anyone today has not seen any of the Star Wars films. Well, our next guest has not only found someone, but also documented his journey as he dove deep into that galaxy far, far away.
Dale Wentland created the podcast series Discovering Star Wars on Network 1901 and is now joining us to tell us all about it.
Hey, hey, Dale!
Hey, hey!
You gotta sound like a Muppet character when you come on our show.
And he did.
I also kind of look like one, too.
Oh, well, awesome.
Awesome!
Do you have blue fur or green?
Oh, both.
Wow.
I'm spotted.
Well, now you're going to talk like a Muppet for this whole discussion.
Waka, waka, waka.
All right, let's end that right now.
Okay.
Well, either way, we're so happy to have you on our show. And we were on the D-Cast, your show, last year. So
yeah, episode 93.
Episode 93.
Yeah, nice. It was. Yeah, you could still go back and check that out on YouTube or on the feed, on the podcast feed, episode 93, where you guys were on. It was great.
Nice.
And now we get to have you on our show.
Yes, I forced my way on.
Well, you know, sometimes you got to do that.
Well, you know what? You had a great hook with your new podcast series, Discovering Star Wars. So tell us all about this series.
Yeah, well, I had a friend who's a film student, nonetheless, who had never seen the Star Wars movies. And
he's a film student?
Yeah, he is. He read the script for Star Wars. That has later been revealed to me. He read the script, but he'd never seen Star Wars. So, and it was like dissecting the script and taking elements. Like, he read the script through parts, you know, as like a lesson. So it's not really, but anyways, so he'd never seen them. And I was like, you know what? There's always this debate on which order to see them in. And people are like, you can't watch the prequels and you know, or watch them, you know, 6 and 7 and 4 and the machete order and all that stuff.
Right.
And I'm like, so what we should do is we should just watch them chronologically.
Nice. Nice.
And he was like, yeah, let's do it. So episode 1 of the show is kind of just talking about his baseline knowledge of Star Wars. Mm. So we kind of know what he knows through Simpsons, Family Guy, like pop culture type references.
Oh, okay, right? So kind of like how I watched Planet of the Apes.
yeah, exactly.
Because I totally knew the ending because of Spaceballs.
Yeah.
But I had never seen it.
Yeah, and there's a Simpsons episode.
Simpsons ending.
So, exactly. And so we talk about that. And then we watch, or he watches episode 1, Phantom Menace, and he won't watch another Star Wars until we record our episode and talk about it. Mm. And then he would watch another one. And we tried to keep it really scientific as we could and have, like, you know, a controlled situation. And also, I think, like, binge watching really changes how you feel about stuff. And I wanted to find out if watching Star Wars chronologically made the prequels better, like made you enjoy the experience more. Mm-hmm. And so episode one, he watches it. He's like, yeah, it's fine. You know, like there's some plot issues and some story issues and some character problems I have. But like it was enjoyable. Like it's about, you know, space wizards. And I was like, yeah, it's not bad. But then episode two, he really starts to get into it. And through the series, you start to see Andrew just really develop this passion for Star Wars. This is geared towards people who love Star Wars. You know, it's geared towards giving people an experience that they can't have with Star Wars, because I'm never going to be able to watch Star Wars in this order for the first time. I know you guys aren't able to watch Star Wars in the order, right? So I wanted to give that to people. And so he even watched, it was episode one, episode two, episode three, Rogue One.
Oh, nice.
A New Hope. Yeah, and then we finished off with Force Awakens. And I asked him before he watched A New Hope, try to figure out what plot hole Rogue One fixed. And he didn't know that he was like, I don't know what was the plot hole. And I'm like, oh, how could you blow up the Death Star through, like, why would they build a chamber to blow it up? And he was like, oh, yeah, I guess so. But no, that had a huge backstory.
Wow.
Yeah, well, so I am so cool. Jealous. Yeah. I would love to go back in time or do whatever I got to do and watch him chronologically with Rogue One right in the middle.
Yeah. And it's just such a cool experience for him. You know, it was even funny. He's like, I think the Senator Palpatine is going to be like a bad guy. And it's like,
Nice. So we got the foreshadowing there.
Yeah. Wow. This has been great.
How old is Andrew?
He is 33.
Okay.
30. No, wait a minute. How do you get to be 33 and never had seen any of the Star Wars films?
I don't want to say, okay, well, when he was growing up, when he was a younger man, sometimes he made decisions about things and just stuck to his guns no matter what. And I think now he's a different person and he's open to the idea of enjoying things that he may have not thought he would have enjoyed. So it's kind of, you know, like it's like a re-coming of age story.
Okay. So it's like when you don't watch something or something and all of a sudden you're special because of that. So you want to keep that.
Yeah.
I can see that. There was some people in college, like a girl in college was like that. She's like, I'm not going to see Star Wars. Blah, blah, blah. Ugh. I know.
Yeah. No, I know my friend, his Star Wars is his biggest passion next to Game of Thrones and like the books, and his girlfriend won't watch Star Wars and never has. And I'm like, well, that's the thing he's most passionate about.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't get those kind of relationships. So you said that he really liked Attack of the Clones, which is one of my favorite Star Wars films. What about it did he really like?
Well, he felt how it was filmed was really well done, and he liked the time jump. Time jumps don't happen very often in American storytelling like that. And because Star Wars takes from Japanese storytelling, you get a time jump. And so he really pays attention to that type of stuff. And he really enjoys that experience.
Do you mean a time jump from Phantom Menace to Attack of the Clones?
Because there's 10 years.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And so in, like, say, anime storytelling, often what will happen is a series midway mark, they'll just skip 2 years of story, and everyone will just be better and stronger and new.
Wow.
Being a film student, I know as a film student, when I would watch a movie, I would watch it. I could only watch it in a certain way. What things did he pick up on? Technical aspects, or like you were saying, more the storytelling?
Yeah. Well, he's a film writer, right? When he went to film school, it was really on writing, and he's been part of a production. He has a YouTube show that won awards here in Canada called Bob and Andrew, and he's very whimsical, but he's a great storyteller, and so he really focuses on story and character, and that's really what draws him. And his favorite character, like the journey of Obi-Wan Kenobi for him is so different than my journey of Obi-Wan Kenobi. And for him, it's like this little Padawan grew up and became like this master. And he really just watches the movie, all the movies through Obi-Wan in a lot of ways, which I don't think you get if you don't watch them chronologically.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. It's really interesting. And even in, what is it? Revenge of the Sith, he comments about the Death Star plans and, you know, how now that the Death Star plans are this MacGuffin that gets this huge backstory that even adds more meaning in A New Hope for him. Because for us, when we watch A New Hope, we're like, oh yeah, they got the Death Star plans. Oh, cool. Right. But like, that wasn't the goal. Like, they already got them. Who, like, move on. That was just like, it's a MacGuffin and it's exposition. Mm. Okay, great. But for him now, like, it's like this story of these Death Star plans. Like, they really, like, it goes on a journey. And there's so much more meaning when they mention the plans.
Was there something that he saw and turned your head on, or something new that he pointed out that you never considered?
Yeah, that George Lucas is a really great storyteller, and he just had dialogue issues, and we should probably say sorry to him.
Even George knows this, but you can't ignore the fact that George was copying the 1930s serials, which had the very wooden dialogue. So, so you can say that he was a great writer because he copied that vernacular and that speech pattern perfectly. Like people who keep on going on about Hayden Christensen, who I thought was fantastic in Attack of the Clones, but he was directed to be very, very stoic. And you can see the internal conflict in Anakin's mind where he wants to be more of a person, but the way he's been taught by Obi-Wan is to suppress your feelings and you can't love. And that's his biggest struggle right there, is to love. And he's got this incredible mind war going on. Mm-hmm. So I love those scenes.
Andrew, and it is so funny that you say that. Andrew agrees with you like 100% in that regard. You should like really listen to it, because just Andrew's, you'll agree with Andrew and be so fascinated by the things you see that Andrew sees in a way that we don't see. But like, one of the things that we're kind of talking about was John Solo kind of revealed it a bit on his YouTube video about the high ground comment. And about how Anakin is in the same situation that Obi-Wan Kenobi was in during the Darth Maul battle. The battle that Obi-Wan would have replayed in his mind over and over again, because it's when his master died.
Right.
And Anakin is like, I'm going to come at you. And Obi-Wan's like, no, don't do it. I have the high ground. Like, you know, I know this situation. And then what does he do? He does the perfect defense. Like, if you even watch Anakin, he jumps just like Obi-Wan Kenobi did. Mm-hmm. And Obi-Wan has the perfect defense for it, because he knows exactly what he did. And I was like, oh my goodness. And, you know, and being able to talk to Andrew about that so soon after he watched Revenge of the Sith, like, I feel, and it also kind of protects him from some of the negativity, where he's kind of looking for things that we didn't necessarily look for the first time when we watched Star Wars.
Right.
Well, we were also watching the prequels through those lenses of having, you know, like our nostalgia lenses.
Right.
Yes. And we wanted to remove nostalgia from him.
Right.
And that's what we kind of say, is that we were trying to remove nostalgia for him. And I think we accomplished it. And he's a Star Wars fan now, and we watched chronologically, so we didn't ruin his life.
Well, good. So is he going to go back and watch like the Clone Wars and Star Wars Rebels?
So we've talked about that. I think we were actually talking about maybe doing Discovering Harry Potter, because he hadn't seen Harry Potter. And then as the new movies come out, I think we're going to revisit Star Wars, but in between, maybe sprinkle some of that stuff in.
Okay.
You know, maybe not do an episode by episode of Clone Wars.
Or like some arcs or something like
that. Yeah, or like season by season, maybe. Mm. You know, something along those lines. But, you know, he's a busy man, too, and I don't want to take up too much of his time.
Has he seen Raiders of the Lost Ark?
Oh, yeah. I know, right? Because you're like, well, if you haven't seen Star Wars, who knows what you haven't seen?
what kind of movies is he into as a 33-year-old film student? What is his background?
Well, that's the thing. Actually, the funniest thing is he went into Attack of the Clones. He's like, oh, cool, Hayden Christensen. I love Hayden Christensen. because he knows him from Life is a House and Shattered Glass.
Oh, yeah.
And so he knows just this actor, and he's like, oh, sweet. And so he's totally okay with Anakin's performance and Hayden Christensen's performance. I mean, and so am I. Like, I think that he did such an accurate job. I think even now that, you know, like, you see Kylo Ren and you see you see
his
what
inner struggle.
Yeah, I think Anakin's a great inner struggle.
Well, now, was this your idea, or did he come to you and say, hey, I've got an idea for a podcast?
It was my idea, because he had said that he'd never seen Star Wars, and we'd been thinking about working together on something, and we were like, oh, we should start writing jokes together. And and he was kind of like, well, let's maybe do something that you do and see how we work together first. And everyone seems to want to do that to me, but and so we did, and it's been a blast. And he is going to start a wrestling podcast. I think that's what he wants to move on to as like a full-time thing.
Oh, he got the bug, because once you start podcasting,
oh, yeah,
that's it.
Yeah.
That
I know
it, and soon you'll realize I can make films, which is a pain in the neck, or I could do something like podcasting, where it's just me and maybe one other person and a computer.
Yeah,
I guess you could do that with films too. But ugh.
Well, and he's so good in the format. You know, it the first few episodes I'm kind of guiding him along, but in I would say Empire Strikes Back and Return of the Jedi, I kind of let the reins off of him, and he really just has great visual dialogue. You know, he just really can paint a picture for you of what he's trying to describe.
So nice. Having seen The Simpsons and Family Guy, he knew all about the Darth Vader moment in The Empire Strikes Back.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. Everyone knows about that stuff. And he knew brother. He knew the brother and sister angle.
Oh, okay.
That's the one argument everyone has when watching and how to watch the films. And everyone says, no, you're going to spoil the big moment of I Am Your Father. But for me, I would rather go back and see it as an arc, as a whole story, instead of focusing on one moment, which is a surprising, shocking moment. But I'd rather see how this little boy grew up to be such a monster who didn't want to be this monster. And all he wanted to do was love.
Totally. And also, like, the moment's always taken away from you because you know the prequels exist, you know that Darth Vader's Anakin Skywalker, and you know the prequels are about Anakin Skywalker, right? So and you know Luke Skywalker's name. So you can piece everything together yourself. But yeah, that, like, the thing about watching them in order that we're discovering is it makes the storytelling better because and now you have like these breaks. And again, Japanese storytelling. It's what's so great about the Japanese storytelling elements of Star Wars is that now the Death Star, like, it, like, think about The Force Awakens is leading up to like the big boss right now, right? Like, they're leading up to a big conflict, and they took like a break, and they're like, actually, here's a little backstory of this device that you guys all remember, and it just enriched the whole saga. And so he just has this really rich, when we watch, like, it's a little bit of a spoiler, but we don't really talk about too much. When we watched Force Awakens, because we watched it together, mm-hmm. when it said Luke Skywalker is missing, he like flipped because it's such a saga. Like, well, we're not going to be watching a Skywalker this. Like, we don't watch a Skywalker for what we know in The Force Awakens.
Right. Now, you know. From what we know, yes.
Yeah.
What did he think of the original trilogy as compared to the prequel trilogy? And some people will think that the original trilogy is a little bit slower after watching the fast-paced, high-action movies that are the prequels.
Yeah, and he takes note of that. But again, he, being a film writer, he knows how to kind of put himself in an era. And he even talks about... He even talks about, like, Citizen Kane, using Citizen Kane as an example. Or no, Godfather. He uses Godfather as an example, where it's phenomenal storytelling that's just told in a different way than stories are told now.
Yeah.
And so he's – I think he that's why he was so perfect for this, because he – I feel like it was almost as pure as you could get, in a sense that maybe not pure for exposure, but pure for openness. and enough understanding to understand why things were good or why things were bad.
Now, I know you said that you were going to continue on with Harry Potter.
Would you... Oh, but to answer, sorry, I didn't answer you.
Oh, go ahead.
Sorry. But I think his favorite order goes Empire Strikes Back, Return of the Jedi, Revenge of the Sith.
Okay.
I think that was being open-minded to the prequels for sure.
Hmm. Would you consider using someone else for your volume 2, your season 2?
You know, I haven't thought about that, but if there was somebody out there who had never seen Star Wars and was excited to talk about it, we probably could even change up the way we do it, maybe, to have like a different test subject, or we could prove that chronological does keep working. We could just make this bigger. We could just be like this big case for watching them chronologically, which again, I think is the best way. And I think if you have a friend who's never seen Star Wars, just suggest chronologically because it enriches the story.
I think that'd be such an interesting podcast series to continue on and watching it in different order and seeing what works for people what order they prefer, and maybe with some younger kids in their teens and how they view the series.
Yeah, definitely younger kids.
You know, my 5-year-old is much more engrossed with Force Awakens and Rogue One than he is even the prequels.
Interesting.
Wait a minute, your 5-year-old saw Rogue One?
Yeah, it's fine. There's not anything as bloody as in all the other Star Wars films.
Oh, I agree. And I don't know why it's rated PG-13. If it were me, I would say it's like PG-7.
Yeah. And I know he's only 5, but in our house, we do talk about the movies we watch a lot. Mm. And we talk about the meanings behind things. Or like when we watch Zootopia, I ask them like, oh, like, what did you think about Zootopia? You know, okay, did it kind of tell you anything? And they were like, well, that, you know, everybody's different and it doesn't matter. And I was like, that's a great, I was like, I love you guys so much. So, you know, I think when I took him to Rogue One, I asked him about how he felt about it and stuff like that. But I had seen it before and he asked, you know, and he's excited and I'm not going to rein him in.
Right.
Not on. Boy, what a very responsible way to watch movies.
Yeah.
Highest kudos to you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, thanks. Well, I think people get on movies being like, oh, you shouldn't watch movies. Like, books are way better. It's just a medium to tell a story. It's just a medium to tell a story.
Right.
And if you make the medium educational and you talk about the story in the same way you would with a book, you know, I think that you're trying to at least teach people how to watch stuff and how to, because you're not going to get rid of TV and movies and stuff. So at least make it something that they're taking from it.
Right.
Oh, yeah. And there's so many different ways to watch a movie, too, with so many different story elements and filmmaking and structure and acting wise. I think there's so much to it. So to those who say just watching movies is not the good way to go, I say no.
Yeah. And Dale, you know what? You've certainly piqued my interest to listening to this podcast series. I hadn't been able to yet, but it's on my podcast list now, and I think I'm going to put it up to the top.
Oh, sweet. Yeah, thank you.
So where can our Skywalkers find Discovering Star Wars? Can you remind us?
Yeah, so it's on the Network 1901 podcast feed. That's iTunes, Stitcher, Google, you know, Podbean. But also... and that if you do the podcast feed, it's January 13th, 2017 was the first episode. But if it's easier for you, you can actually just go to network1901.com and we have just a section of the webpage that has all the episodes there as well.
Nice. All right. Well, thank you so much for joining us. And where can our Skywalkers find you on social media?
Oh, I'm at Dale Wentland on everything. So if you want to find me personally, I'm at Dale Wentland. But I also do a lot with the at Network 1901 Twitter accounts and stuff like that.
Nice. Well, thank you. And that makes it certainly easy for us.
Yeah. And thank you for discovering the series, Discovering Star Wars. It's such a unique twist on a podcast series. So highest kudos to you.
Thank you. And thank you so much for having me. I am just so honored. You know, you guys are the cutest podcast couple ever. And everyone at Network 1901 loves you. And I just thank you so much for your time.
Oh,
don't know where to go from there.
Thank you, Dale.
Well, that wraps up episode 159 of
Skywalking Through Neverland. We want to thank Chris Sonnenberg and Ben Balestrieri, the Tangled guys.
We also want to thank Amanda Bond and Gabriel Colbaugh, Dale Wentland,
and all of you Skywalkers for taking the time out of your schedules and listening each and every week and then sharing the show around. Like, that's so amazing.
And thanks to Amanda for letting us know how Gabriel Colbaugh pronounces his name.
Yay!
All right, now, well, if you guys want to listen to some more fun shows, well, head on over there to RetroZap.com, where you can find really great shows like Brews and Blasters,
Starships, Sabers and Scoundrels, or S-Cubed,
the Sandcrawler Podcast,
Beltway Banthas, which is all about politics and Star Wars,
Techno Retro Dads, and Talking Apes TV, which we're going to record in 25 minutes.
Oh, wow.
For the next episode.
Holy buckets, this is recording day.
Yeah.
And you can also find Skywalking Through Neverland at jedinews.co.uk. And Richard, you're celebrating the 20th anniversary of the Star Wars Special Editions by writing an article over there.
Yeah, in one more week, we're going to celebrate the 20th anniversary of Return of the Jedi Special Edition.
Woohoo, where I went on my 16th birthday to see it.
Yay. So if you want to hear all about my adventures 20 years ago, head on over there to jedinews.co.uk.
Now, we are on social media. We are at Skywalking Pod, pretty much on any social media platform that is big. Twitter, Instagram, Periscope. And we have our lovely Facebook group, which is a closed group on Facebook. And it is closed for a reason, because we're trying to keep out spammers, which are weird. So, if you want to join the Facebook group and you have not yet, there is a two-step process. First of all, you have to find the group, which is Skywalking Through Neverland Facebook group, and request to join, and then you have to find us somewhere else on social media, message us or DM us or whatever, and say, hey, I asked to join the Facebook group. My name is blah, and I'm a listener.
There you go.
All right.
All right, now stay tuned for some bits that didn't fit into the show because we flubbed up, or bits of conversations that just were extraneous, so we lifted them out and put them right here for your listening pleasure.
Or Sarah swears.
Luckily, this week, she did not swear.
No, even so though you gave me a good damn reason.
Oh! So close! So close. You will never be heard in India now.
Is not a bad word.
All right, you know what? Blah, 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 blah. All right, with that, always remember to cut out before it's too late, and
never land on Alderaan.
Some imagination, huh?
To our Skywalkers and Tweetwalkers, thanks for listening. Skywalking Through Neverland is created and produced by Richard and Sarah Woloski. Original music by Rob Dellinger. Creative consultant, Mark Augushowitz. Technical advisor, Peter Heitman. Facebook administrators, Donald Wicks, Joey Pittman, and Norma Heitman.
Skywalking Through Neverland is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. Any sounds, music, and clips played during this podcast are the property of their copyright holders. All original content is property of Skywalking Through Neverland, all rights reserved. Sorry, had to be said. Hey, Skywalkers, welcome to
Skywalking Through Neverland.
This is your fun-filled Star Wars and... I'm sorry, did that just flicker?
No, it went low. Oh, now it's back to two. It's fine.
Okay, it looked to me like it turned off.
It just dims. Okay. It dims after the first couple seconds.
It's happened before.
I know.
We're recording and all of a sudden we're not recording.
Out.
We're talking with no recording being done.
Yeah, it's terrible. Okay.
All right, here we go.
And Joe Pittman just says, just smolder.
I've gotten a smolder down yet.
I'm waiting. You have to do it to me, silly.
Okay.
You can't do the eyebrow thing,
yeah,
it just doesn't work.
I can't do the eyebrow thing.
Yeah, you have to do the eyebrow thing.
I've always been jealous of my friend Jim Prue. You could always do the John Belushi eyebrow raise.
Yes, my friend Allison could do that. And yeah, it looks phenomenal. And it's like, I just can't do it.
I would love that talent. If I could have a superpower, it would be to raise my one eyebrow. That would be it.
But what would it do?
It would give me a smoldering look. Need I say more? That's my superpower.
And why do you need a smoldering look now?
So when you ask me for a smoldering look, I could give you a smoldering look.
Okay.
See?
All you have to do is wear the Thor outfit. I brought it back around.
Yes, you did. Nicely done. Now bring it back around to Star Wars Episode 9.
Okay.
Eden Espinosa. There's an N there.
There's an N, but Espinosa. There's not two N's.
Eden Espinosa. What? Espinosa. Eden Espinosa. Did I say that right?
I think so.
Espinosa.
This is something different we're going into. Yeah.
Okay, then you lead this because I thought we were going to go into my question.
Oh, not yet. No, so you asked me this.
Oh, okay. I jumped the gun.
Yes, you did.
All righty then.
Here we go. All right, here we go.
I think they should just cut the music from the series.
What are you talking about? Do I have to get mad at you? Patty, you tell Richard what's up.
Do not. Okay, you know what? Do not curse. Do not. You know what? I'm sorry I went there.
You almost made me curse.
Hashtag Sarah curses.
No, it's Sarah swears.
Sarah swears.
Because it's an alliteration. Stop that.
I should have rethought my actions, I apologize.
So. All right, so we'll get into that. He talks about his account at Follow Pascal. So if you guys are on Instagram right now, go to at Follow Pascal. It's super cute. He hasn't posted the picture of us yet, but hopefully they will.
Little does Chris know, we stole his Pascal. Don't tell him. And we replaced it with an exact replica.
Uh-oh. Actually, mine is smaller.
Shh.
Okay.
Yes, and.
Okay. All right. Well, now... Okay, well, how am I going to do this? So was that our coming out, or was that just to talking to them?
I was talking to the face huggers.
All right.
I say that just so we can roll in the alien music.
Okay.
All right, where are we?
All right, so now we're coming out of that one. Just what he said about the computer program, I find it fascinating. Bleh. Okay. Let me try that again. Okay.
I was looking at a face hugger comment where someone was referring to Beavis and Butthead.
Stop it! No!
Oh,
Dad.
Jay Pitty says, step in time with Beavis and Butthead. Oh, yeah. You said
stop.
Beavis.
No, don't. No.
Shut up, Beavis.
No.
Yeah.
No, nails on a chalkboard. Stop it. No, sweetie.
Okay. Tangle's cool.
No. Tangle. No.
You said
stop
tangled.
Stop it. I don't like it. I don't like it. Okay. So... Stop it, you guys. Stop encouraging him. Oh, my God. Thank you, Chris.
Chris says, loves them. Yeah, me too.
No, stop
Beavis
it.
Beavis and Butthead, awesome.
No. All right. Let me go back to this.
By Amanda Bond and Gabriel. From Amanda Bond and Gabriel Colbaugh.
Is it Colbaugh?
Colbaugh. What did I say? Colbaugh?
You say like Colbaugh.
Colbaugh.
Because you're seeing it spelled. I think it's Colbaugh.
Colbaugh.
Amanda. What is it?
Okay, take two. From Amanda Bond and Gabriel Colbaugh. Let's give them lightsabers.
Yes.
Rapunzel with a lightsaber. Didn't we see Rapunzel with a lightsaber in Disney Infinity?
In Disney Infinity.
Well, okay, so now it all comes full circle.
All right. So they asked, what are you most proud of continuing Tangled, the original story? Right, and that's pretty much the end.
Joey's light bulbs. All right. Joey, get to work on this. Where can we take this?
Me.
Oh, sorry.
Back. Okay. Are you ready?
No. Go ahead.
Okay. All right. You can also find Skywalking Through Neverland at Jedi Knows.
Jedi what now?
Jedi knows.
Never land on Alderaan.
Best day ever. Always go to Corona and never land on Alderaan.
No, don't go to Corona. It's too far.
Why not? Corona? I like Corona. Corona's where Rapunzel...
It's hot. They only have that one fair there.
What? No, Corona's where Rapunzel lives.
Oh, that Corona.
What are you thinking of?
Corona, California, up the street.
Oh, no. Kingdom of Corona.
Okay. Isn't that a beer?
Essing. Okay. Cursing co-hosts. I think that's what that means. Amanda.
Unbelievable.
All right. Are we done?
I'm sorry you guys had to hear
that.
That
was like quick after that. All right. All right. I'm pausing.
Yeah.
Oh. All right. All right. Bye.
And there you go. All right.
Wow.